Previously on Khan Academy, I claimed to cover the basics of a limit. However, some may argue that I have been misleading. After all, I'm not Daniel Khan, and worse, I didn't make it clear what kind of limit I was talking about. Limit is definitely an overused term in math, and my usage of the term limit is relatively new in the grand scheme of things. If you read older literature, you'll come across many other terms of similar nature, such as direct limit, inverse limit, projective limit, injective limit. Can you tell which of these limits correspond to the limits I was talking about? Exactly right. A direct limit is direct because when compared to the limits I was talking about, they're directly the opposite. They're an example of colimits. Wait, what's a colimit? Well, to answer that question, we will need to unlearn everything I taught you last time. If you watched the video on limits, then formally speaking, you're one step away from understanding what a colimit is. Let's not beat around the bush this time. A colimit in a category C is a limit in the opposite category. If you're still here, thank you for watching. If you like what you watched, unclick the dislike button. If you didn't like what you watched, it's fine. If the collection of fans who've got my back form an initial object, then that object is probably a zero object. Alright, fine. Let's unpack the definition. Given some category C, you obtain its opposite by reversing all of its arrows. In order to understand the ramifications of this, we'll have to review the concept of a limit. Given some diagram F, the limit of F is some object with a property that it admits a projection map pi j to each object aj in the diagram. The point of being a limit is that a limit is universal with this property. In other words, if any other object, S, has its own projection maps, pj, to each of the aj's, then there exists a unique map u from S to our limit, such that every pj factors as u followed by pi j. If you think this review was too short, then I hope you find a 26 minute and 15 second video that can supplement this. Anyway, reversing the arrows, we get a more explicit definition of a colimit. Specifically, given another diagram G, the colimit of G is some object with the property that it admits injection maps iota j to each object bj in the diagram. A colimit is similarly universal with this property. If any other object T has its own injection maps ij to each object bj, then there exists a unique map V from the colimit of G to T such that every map ij factors as iota j followed by V. Now, if I were talking to a bunch of machines that already understand the concept of a limit, I could stop here. Thank you for watching. However, being human, we have to face our own biases. Although colimits are, from a purely formal point of view, just as simple as limits, your personal experience with colimits may beg to differ. But why would this be? If the definition is just a formal dual of the definition of a limit, then why should colimits feel so different? The answer is that this is the wrong question. The reason colimits feel different, or dare I say, more difficult than limits, has nothing to do with colimits themselves, but rather with the kinds of categories we tend to find ourselves working in. After all, a colimit would only be difficult in the category C if the corresponding limit were difficult in the opposite of C. Let's look at a small example so we can understand what I'm talking about. Let's consider the category of monoids. What's a monoid? Well, a monoid is a set equipped with a multiplication and a unit, such that the multiplication is associative and the unit is neutral. I don't want to dwell too much on monoids, but I feel it's important to stress that a monoid multiplication is not necessarily commutative. There is no reason for A times B to be equal to B times A in general. This might make monoids feel less intuitive, so here's a more concrete representation. Start with a bunch of square matrices of a fixed dimension. If you add the identity matrix and take all possible finite products of these matrices, then this will generate a monoid. For our simple example of a colimit, let's consider a very small monoid, the monoid C2 of two elements, plus 1 and minus 1, where multiplication is the ordinary multiplication of numbers. My diagram of interest is the diagram with two copies of C2. Before we contemplate the colimit of this diagram, let's look at the diagram's limit. If you recall from the previous video, the limit of this diagram is called the product of the two copies of C2. The product monoid has 2 times 2, or 4, elements, corresponding to all possible pairs of elements from C2. The multiplication on pairs is given element-wise. If you're wondering, we can represent the elements of C2 times C2 with diagonal matrices of plus ones and minus ones. Now that we know what the limit is, what about the colimit? Just as the limit of this diagram gives us a product, the colimit of the diagram gives us a so-called coproduct. I was taught in my graduate teaching and learning program that good instruction requires audience engagement. So here's a question for all of you. Given that C2 has two elements, how many elements does the coproduct of C2 with itself have? Is it A, two elements, because both factors are C2, or B, three elements, the neutral one, the minus one from the first factor, and the minus one from the second factor? Is it C, four elements, because 2 times 2 equals 4? Or is it D, four elements, because addition is dual to multiplication and 2 plus 2 is 4? Or is it E, infinitely many elements, because, well, just because. Need a hint? Here are matrix generators for the categorical product, and matrix generators for the categorical coproduct. If you multiply the two generators of the coproduct together, you get a diagonal of ones as well as a 1 on the top right corner. If you take this matrix and multiply it with itself n times, you get a diagonal of ones and an n on the top right corner. Since all of these products are different, the correct answer is E, infinitely many elements. If you answered this question wrong, that's okay. Allow yourself to go through the 5 stages of grief. Not confusingly, in the category of monoids, the coproduct is called the free product. Now that we see what I mean by colimits being harder than limits, let's talk about why this is. Like I said earlier, the fault lies in the categories that we study, rather than the colimits themselves. The reason for this imbalance of difficulty is actually quite elementary. If you recall from the video on limits, mapping into some object x generalizes the idea of taking elements of x. This is based on the observation that elements of a set x naturally correspond to functions from a singleton into x. This analogy motivates limits as a means of elevating element-based set theoretic constructions to other categories. Just like how we can construct the Cartesian product of sets whose elements are given by pairs of elements from each of its factors, we can construct a product object in some other category whose incoming arrows are given by pairs of arrows, one going into each factor. After reversing arrows to get into the opposite category, we are now finding maps out of our object X. What does that correspond to? Co-elements? What would that even mean? Since the birthplace of elements is the category of sets, it's natural to look there first to get an understanding of coelements. In this case, we don't need to guess. Coelements of sets are just elements of objects of the opposite of set. Snarkiness aside, this is actually really helpful if you've watched my video on the subject. We can identify the opposite of a set X with its power set, that is, the collection of all subsets of X. I won't belabor why this is, as there's already a 17-minute and 15-second explanation of it online. But let me at least summarize how taking power sets reverses functions. If I have a function of sets g from y to x, I get a function of power sets going the other way by sending a subset of x to its preimage in y. You can think of preimages as generalized inverses for these functions, and this gives us a concrete way of reversing the arrows. Interestingly, using union and intersection of subsets, the category of power sets actually defines a category of algebras. This will be especially handy later, because it means we can use limits in set to calculate limits in the opposite category. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Now that we know what the opposite of sets are, we can use this to determine what coelements are. In the ordinary category of sets, an arrow f from x to y is a function that sends an element of x to an element of y. In the opposite category, an arrow g from x to y is a preimage function, which means that it sends a subset of x to a subset of y. In particular, it's the subsets that serve as an analog of elements in this opposite category. To really drive this point home, let omega denote the two-element set whose elements are called true and false. Then, subsets of x correspond to functions from x to omega. In one direction, we can identify a subset of x with its characteristic function, which is a function that indicates true or false whether an element is in S or not. In the opposite direction, given a function g from x to omega, we define a subset by taking the set of all elements of x that g maps to true. With this set omega, we can actually see the duality between elements and subsets. Unless you wasted your second year summer doing too much set theory like I did, this might take some time to digest and appreciate. The astute among you might have noticed, however, that I've been assuming the law of the excluded middle. So, with our new understanding that coelements of sets are subsets, let's try to calculate some colimits of sets. Of course, I don't have the kind of time necessary to calculate all types of colimits, but luckily, I don't have to. In the previous Khan Academy video, we saw that if a category has all limits, then these limits can be built up from two special cases, products and equalizers. By the power of duality, this means that if a category has all colimits, then these colimits can be built up from coproducts and coequalizers, so I'll just focus on these ones. Let's first look at calculating coproducts. Remember that for products, given an element of x and an element of y, we get a unique element of the product, which is a pair whose first component is the element of x and the second component is the element of y. Entirely dually, given a subset S of x and a subset T of y, there should be a unique subset of the coproduct of x and y, whose restriction to x is S and whose restriction to y is T. Now the question is, what kind of sets have subsets that correspond to a pairing of a subset of x with a subset of y? It can be a little bit difficult to try and reason about sets in terms of their subsets only, but subsets also give us information about the elements of the coproduct. Indeed, each element of a set defines a singleton subset of that set. And as we can see, the singleton subsets are the second smallest subsets when ordered by inclusion. In other words, to learn what the elements of the coproduct of x and y is, we just need to think about what the second smallest subsets of the coproduct look like. The smallest subsets of x and y are both given by empty subsets. If we pair those together, we get the smallest subset of the coproduct. On the other hand, if we pair singleton subsets of x with singleton subsets of y, we get slightly larger subsets of the coproduct. However, these subsets are the third smallest. We get the second smallest subsets of the coproduct by pairing a singleton with an empty set. This means that an element of the coproduct of x and y corresponds to an element of exactly one of x or y paired with an empty set. In other words, the coproduct of sets corresponds to the disjoint union of these sets. This concludes our study of coproducts. Now, coequalizers are a bit more conceptually demanding. Suppose we have two functions f and g mapping from a set x to the set y. Let's recall first that the equalizer corresponds to the set of all elements of x whose image in y via f and g are the same. In other words, f of x equals g of x. Dually, we only know how to describe the coequalizer of these two functions in terms of its power set. Specifically, the subsets of the coequalizer correspond to the subsets of y whose pre-images in x via f or g are the same. In particular, the coequalizer will generally have fewer subsets than y does. This makes determining its elements, or its second smallest subsets, a little bit more tricky. The graduate teaching and learning program told me that examples can be extremely illuminating. Suppose x is the three-element set containing 1, 2, and 3, and y is the four-element set consisting of a, b, c, and d. Define the function f by sending 1, 2, and 3 respectively to a, b, and c, and then define a function g that sends 1, 2, and 3 respectively to a, d, and c. Out of the 16 total subsets of y, you can check that only the following 8 persist in the coequalizer. By looking at this graphic, we can see that the second smallest subsets are the following three. Notice in particular that one of them isn't a singleton in y. Nonetheless, these subsets still serve to partition y into three disjoint pieces, and this kind of partitioning remains true for all coequalizers in general, at least in the category of sets. As a set, we can conceptually think of the coequalizer as the three-element set obtained by taking y and then gluing b and d together. The reason why b and d are glued together is because f of 2 is b and g of 2 is d. Indeed, if a subset t of y contains some f of x, then x is in the preimage of t under f. If this preimage is equal to the preimage of t under g, then this means that t must also contain g of x as well, In particular, any subset of the coequalizer that contains f of x must also contain g of x, and vice versa. Overall, we see that the coequalizer of two maps into a set Y is given by taking the set Y and coercing that f of x is equal to g of x for every x. Now that we have an understanding of how coproducts and coequalizers work, we get a good overall picture of colimits of sets. In the world of limits, products serve to build up sets by bundling together a bunch of elements, and equalizers serve to filter the set out according to equations. In the dual world of colimits, coproducts serve to build up sets by collecting a bunch of individual elements, and coequalizers serve to refine a set by folding and gluing elements together according to equations. If you're still here, thank you for watching. If you like what you watched, I hope the quotient of all screen elements by the equivalence generated by clicking identifies your mouse with a particular YouTube button. If you didn't like what you watched, it's fine. At My Back is one I've always been a co-fan of.